Once Parvati was having a bath. That time, Lord Shankar came there suddenly. Seeing him, Parvati was shocked. So that this does not happen again, what should be done? While thinking about this, her friend advised to keep a guard at her bathroom door who will only listen to her command. Parvati liked this idea. So Parvati removed dirt from her body, added some perfume to it, and made a statue out of it. Then she chanted a mantra and brought the statue to life. She then made him a guard and commanded that without her permission, nobody must enter her bathroom. Saying this, she made him stand at the door. And according to Parvati's command, this guard used to stand at the door and stop whoever came to that door. Once, Shankar himself came. He made many requests to this little guard to let him in. But all this was a waste of time. He did not listen to any of Shankar's requests or pleas. He just kept repeating, "Mother Parvati is taking a bath. You cannot go in." But this was Shankar. Anger was on the tip of his nose now. In his own house, some small little guard is stopping him from entering his own house. Seeing this, he was very angry. In his anger, he took his trishul and cut off the head of the guard. At once, the small head of this young guard flew in the sky and his body fell on the ground. After some time, Parvati finished and came out. Seeing the headless body of her guard fallen on the ground without life, she was shocked. And she stepped out to destroy the entire universe. Seeing this, all the gods got worried. They started pleading to Shankar. So Shankar asked his servants to search for the head. But after searching everywhere, they couldn't find the head. Shankar ordered his servants to at once cut the head of any animal that they find first and bring it to him. His servants left in search for a head. At the same time, a demon named Gajasur was coming towards Kailash to trouble the gods. His body was of a man and his head was of an elephant. Seeing him, at once Shankar cut off his head and put it on the body of the little guard, enchanted his mantra and brought him to life. Parvati took this Gajvadan as her own son and Shankar appointed him as one of his gun, a trusted servant. They gave Gajvadan the name of Ganesh. Shankar gave blessings to this name that if one begins any new work with this name, that work will succeed without any problems. In this way, the statue made out of the dirt of Parvati's body came to be called Ganapati and was loved by everyone.
One day, when Shankar and Parvati were sitting on Kailash, they were talking to each other. Just nearby, their son Gajanan and Kartikeya were playing.
Sit
seeing them playing with each other happily, Shankar and Parvati were also happy. All of a sudden, while playing, they started fighting. Kartikeya said to Gajanan, "Are Ganesha, you have such a fatty stomach and such big hips, and you travel on that little mouse? He will be smashed with your weight itself. What's the use? Look how I travel on a peacock. He is suitable for my weight as well as beautiful and active. See how this small mouse of yours looks, she?" On that, Gajanan said, "Let it be. Let my unattractive little mouse look the way he is. You look at the legs of your beautiful peacock, so thin like a stick." As they started fighting, there was no end to it. Finally, whose source of travel is much better? To find out this, they went to Shankar and Parvati. After listening to both their opinions, Parvati said, "Look, among the two of you, whoever circles the earth and comes first, his point will be valid." Kartikeya found this challenge very easy. He was confident that he would definitely win and started boasting, "I will definitely complete this race first around the earth." Saying this, he took off on his peacock. Before leaving, he teased Ganpati, "Now you wait and see in a snap, I will complete this race around the earth on my peacock. Just see if your tiny little mouse would be able to walk even 10 steps with your weight." Gajanan just quietly heard Kartikeya. After Kartikeya had left, he went over to the lake and took a bath. And with his wet body itself, he sat on his mouse and went where Shankar and Parvati were sitting. He told them, "You are my parents who have given birth to me, means you are my earth. If I encircle around you, that will be my real encircle around the earth." Saying this, he took 7 circles around Shankar and Parvati and sat down next to them. After some time, Kartikeya returned back from his visit around the earth. Seeing Kartikeya, Parvati said, "Kartikeya, Gajanan has won our challenge. He is intelligent. He has encircled round the earth before you." Hearing this, Kartikeya got angry. He angrily said, "What's this? How can Gajanan complete this encircle round the earth so fast?" On this, Parvati said, "Son, Ganesha took 7 circles round Shankar and myself. You will be fruitful if you go round your parents, as it is the same as taking a circle round the earth. This is a promise in the scriptures." Hearing this, Kartikeya was very angry with Parvati and said, "You like Ganesha more than me, so you are siding him and talking trickily. You don't love me. You are making differences between your two sons. From now on, I don't want to see your face or any other woman's face in the entire universe." Taking this decision, he walked away and went over to Kronchgiri Mountains. And till date, he remained a bachelor. In this manner, on the basis of his intelligence, Ganesha won the love of his mother and father. So children, you must also be intelligent like Ganesh and win the love of your parents, right? Just like Ganesh, you must have high respect for your parents. Then Ganpati Papa will give you success.
Children, you will always find a small mouse at the feet of Ganpati. If you offer prasad to Ganpati in the form of modak, you have to present karanji to the mouse as well. Did you ever think how a mighty god like Ganpati, who is so huge, got a mouse as his mode of transport? Isn't this surprising? So this is the story of how the mouse became Ganpati's mode of transport. Once, there was a singing function held by Lord Indra in his palace, and he called a Gandharva named Kronch immediately. While rushing toward Indra's palace, Kronch Gandharv by mistake happened to kick Vamandev Rishi, who was sitting there. Vamandev Rishi got angry. He cursed the Gandharv that he will turn into a mouse. Because of this curse, Kronch turned into a mouse. And he reached the ashram of Parashar Rishi. This mouse caused a lot of trouble in the ashram. He destroyed the food grains. He ate everything in the ashram. And caused problems for the people in the ashram and Parashar Rishi. Not only this, he ate pages from the books, made holes in the clothes in the ashram. All the students of the ashram tried many tricks to catch this mouse. But all this was in vain. Later, Parashar Rishi in the ashram started to pray to Ganesha. O Ganesha, please release us from the troubles of this mouse. Then Ganesha appeared and with his intelligence trapped the mouse. The mouse then pleaded a lot to Ganpati to have mercy on him and release him. Because the mouse surrendered, Ganpati was pleased and granted him a wish. But the mouse had the nature of a brat. He proudly told Ganpati, "I don't want any wish from you. In fact, you ask me for a wish." Seeing this pride, Ganpati said, "Fine. From now, you shall be my mode of transport." Soon after saying this, Ganpati was sitting on the mouse's back. With Ganpati's weight, the mouse came to his senses. And from that time onwards, the mouse became Ganpati's mode of transport.
This is a story when Shankar and Parvati were living with Ganesh on Kailash. Once when Shankar was asleep, little Ganesha was playing nearby. While playing, his attention went on the moon which is on the forehead of Shankar. At once, he took the moon and started playing. And playing, he went far away. After some time, Shankar woke up. On getting up, he sees that he does not have the moon on his forehead anymore. So he called Nandi and his followers, that is Kan, and asked them about the moon. Kan told that they have seen the moon in Ganpati's hand. At once, Shankar ordered Nandi and Kan to get the moon back from Ganpati. According to the orders, Nandi and Kan left to get the moon back from Ganesha. They saw Ganpati somewhere playing with the moon. So they went to catch him, but as they went to catch him, he vanished. And again, he appeared far away. They went over there to catch him. But again, he disappeared. Likewise, sometimes he appeared and disappeared. Sometimes he became extremely heavy, and sometimes he made them tired and breathless. So this way he had his thing. Finally, when they gave up the pride of their strength, they saw that Ganpati was sitting beside the feet of Lord Shankar, and the moon was on Shankar's forehead. Seeing this miracle, Nandi and Gan said to Shankar, "Lord Shankar, the moon is on your forehead itself." On this, Shankar touched his forehead and truly found the moon on its place. From that day onwards, after seeing Ganpati's child deeds, Shankar's Gan realized the great power of Ganpati. And from that day onwards, they obeyed Lord Ganesha. That's why people call him Master of the Gan, which means Ganpati, and God of the Gan, which means Ganesh.
Children, this is a story of Ganesha as a child. Shankar and Parvati used to live along with Ganesh on Kailash Mountains. At that time, Kuber, the treasurer of all gods, used to live in heaven. Kuber was very proud of his wealth. He loved to show off his wealth. He had built big palaces. So that he could show off his wealth, he used to organize various events and call all gods to amaze them. No matter how much he used to spend, his wealth would never come to an end. Because of this, he was very proud of his wealth. Similarly, one day, Kuber just came into the mood of showing off his wealth again. So he decided to keep a food feast and also decided to call all the gods. Now Kuber was a strong believer of Shankar. So he decided that the first invitation will be given to this almighty god. He himself left for Mount Kailash to invite Shankar. On reaching Kailash, he stood before Lord Shiva and Parvati, joined both his hands and requested, "My God of gods, if you will be present at my food function, then my function will brighten up. Among all gods, I will be respected more if you come." But Shankar politely refused him by saying that it isn't possible for him to leave Kailash and come. But Kuber was not ready to listen unless Shankar agreed. Just then, Parvati, who was just sitting there, gave an idea. "In your place, why don't you send our son Gajanan to Kuber's function?" Shankar liked this advice. They ensured Kuber that they would definitely send Ganesha to his food function. So Kuber agreed and left to invite other gods. the day of the function arrived. Kuber had made grand preparations for food. He had organized for a vast variety of very delicious food that its aroma spread all across his house. Kuber's servants ran up and down the entire palace to serve the guests. Kuber himself stood at his gate to welcome all guests as they were coming in one after another. After some time, Shankar and Parvati's son, little Ganesha, arrived. As Kuber saw him, he welcomed him gladly. All the other gods saw this unique child of Shankar and greeted him. Kuber himself led Ganesh to the dining table and gave him a chair to sit and requested him to eat as much as he could. He guaranteed Ganesha that there was so much food cooked that it won't fall short for him. Little Ganesh sat for food and started eating. One after another, he started requesting for different dishes. One after another, he finished them all. Soon, all the food that was cooked was over. Still, Ganpati's hunger did not subside. Kuber got ashamed. He politely requested Ganpati, "The food is getting cooked in the kitchen. Once it's completely cooked, it will be served to you." But little Ganesh could not control his hunger. He got up and went into the kitchen. There he ate all the and raw food. Still, his hunger did not subside. So he told Kuber, "All your food is over. Now give me more food or else I will eat you up." Hearing this, Kuber was afraid and ran for his life. Ganesha also ran after him. They ran so far that they reached Kailash. Kuber ran and fell at Shankar's feet and caught his feet and narrated the entire story. After listening, Shankar said to Ganesh, "Ganesha, why are you doing this?" So Ganesh replied, "Kuber had asked me to eat as much food as I could, but he could not serve me the amount of food I wanted, because of which my hunger did not subside. That's why I am after Kuber." So Shankar told Ganesh, "Go to Mother Parvati. She has made modak for you and kept in a plate. Go and eat that." Accordingly, Sri Ganesh left from there. Kuber felt sorry and asked for forgiveness to Shankar. "I was very proud about my wealth. I believed that I could serve food to the entire universe and I was proud of that. But your son ashamed me and made me realize my fault. From now on, I shall never take pride. That's why, children, always remember, the house of pride always remains empty."
Once there was a grand event held in the city of Yum. In that event, many fairies and dancers were dancing. At that event, while Tirottama was dancing, Yum fell in love with this beauty. And a scary rakshas named Analasur was evolved. Wherever Analasur went, fire erupted and destroyed everyone. such a destructive rakshas came towards the gods. All the gods were frightened and started praying to Sri Ganesh. Sri Ganesh appeared there in his child form and ensured all the gods that he would kill Analasur. While coming on his way, Analasur was destroying everything. Seeing him, all the gods were scared to death and started running here and there. But little Ganesh stood there only. Seeing this, Analasur came forward to swallow him. But Ganesh himself swallowed Analasur. But after swallowing Analasur in this form of fire, Ganesh's entire body started burning. He fell to the ground and crawled around. So all the gods came there. Seeing Ganesh's body burning in pain, they started making various remedies. Indra placed Sheetal and pure moon on his head. Brahmadev offered his daughters Siddhi and Buddhi. Vishnu gave his cooling lotus from his hand. Varun poured cooling water. Shankar removed his cobra and put it around Ganesh's stomach. All remedies were tried, but still the burning did not soothe. At that time, 8,800 Rishi Munis came and each of them took 21 green durva and put it on Ganesha's head. Only then the burning sensation of Ganesh soothed. Hence Ganpati got impressed and said, "Various things were tried, but the burning sensation in my body did not settle. But through this durva, it has settled. Hence, from now onwards, whoever offers durva to me will get the blessing which is equal to 1,000 pilgrims, pujas, donations and fastings." From then onwards, Ganesha was also known as Kalanil Prashanam because he killed Analasur. All the gods built a beautiful temple there and made an idol of Gajanan and named it Vignahar.
Among many names of Sri Ganesh, he is also known as Chintamani. But are you aware how he got this name? Let us hear this story to find out. Long ago, a king named Abhijit had a wicked son named Garna, who became the prince. This prince used to mercilessly cheat helpless people and Rishi Munis. Once he went to hunt in Kundanwan, but landed at Kapil Muni's ashram, which was nearby. So Kapil Muni asked Garn to stay over for food. But Garn wondered, what food can I possibly get here in this ashram? Onions and radish? Vegetables made of leaves? But later, what he sees is that there is a beautiful, impressive mandap arranged outside the hut. In the mandap, there were beautiful seating arrangements made for each and everyone. Right in front, there was aromatic food served in silver plates. Kapil Muni invited everyone, including Ganesha, and served them till their stomachs were full. Seeing this luxury, Garn was amazed. He wondered, in such a little time, how did this Muni arrange such a grand meal? So he went to the Muni and inquired. Kapil Muni replied, once I was helpful to Lord Indra, so he gave me a wish-fulfilling Muni. A jewel, which is also called Chintamani. Hearing this, Garna asked Kapil Muni to give him the money. But as Kapil Muni refused, Garna forcibly snatched it from him and took it away. Kapil Muni was very upset that Garna had taken the money. He started praying to Lord Vishnu. So Vishnu advised him to pray to Ganesha. Hence, Kapil Muni sincerely prayed to Sri Ganesh and impressed him and narrated the entire incident to him. Ganesh promised to get back the Chintamani from Garna. Ganesh went on a war along with his army. King Abhijit advised Garna to compromise. But Garna, who was filled with pride, did not listen to his father and went on war against Ganesh. There was a terrible fight between both the armies. The entire army of Garna was destroyed. Then Ganesh threw his axe and cut Garna's head off. Later, Ganesh took the Chintamani from Garna's father and handed it over to Kapil Muni. But Kapil Muni took the Chintamani and put it in Ganesh's neck and said, Ganesh, let this Chintamani remain with you itself. From now on, people will know you as Chintamani. Saying this, Kapil Muni bowed down to Ganesh. From that day on, Chintamani resided on the banks of the Mulamut River in the jungle of Kadambavan in Thur village and was called Vinayak Chintamani. This Thur's Chintamani Vinayak is the second among the Ashtavinayak.
Once Brahmadev went to Kailash to meet Shankar, and Narad also arrived there. He presented an everlasting and precious fruit to Shankar. Kartikeya and Gajanan, both of them were sitting beside Shankar. Both of them started fighting for this fruit. So Shankar wondered, who should he give this fruit to? Brahmadeva advised that the fruit must be given to Kartikeya. So Shankar gave the fruit to Kartikeya. So Gajanan was angry with Brahmadev. Next time, Shankar and Gajanan went to Satyalok to gift Brahmadev. Seeing that Shankar's attention is somewhere else, Gajanan started scaring Brahmadev with his beast-like appearance. Seeing his hostile beast kind of appearance, the moon on Shankar's forehead found this very funny, and he started mocking loudly and laughing at this form of Gajanan. Seeing this, Gajanan got angry and he cursed the moon. "You are making fun of this look of mine? That's why nobody in this entire universe will look at you. And whoever looks at you will commit a mortal sin." Because of Gajanan's curse, the moon lost his beauty and started looking dirty and ugly. Seeing this, the moon was ashamed of himself and he hid himself. All the other gods felt bad when he learnt about this situation. So they all came together and prayed to Sri Gajanan and asked Sri Ganesh to return the moon's beauty back. Indra called the moon and asked him to recite Ekaksha Mantra of Gajanan. Accordingly, the moon devotedly meditated and recited that mantra for 12 years. Seeing that the moon is regretting, Ganesha was pleased and blessed him. "May you get your previous beauty back. And on every month of Krishna Chaturthi, until your darshan is not taken, my puja will not be complete. Only after taking your darshan, my faithful devotees will eat and break their fast. Likewise, I shall wear one of your art on my head with pride. But on Bhadrapad Chaturthi, whosoever looks at you will get a blame of robbery." After getting this blessing, his ugliness vanished and once again the moon became bright as before. From that day onwards, the art of the moon on Ganpati's head looks admirable, and that's why Ganesha is also known as Bhalchandra.
A long time ago, there lived a king named Satraji in Yadav Kula. He did puja of the sun for 100 years and pleased the sun lord, who gave him a bright Samantak money. The rays of this money were as bright as the sun. Through this money, the king got gold every day. So this king used to serve food regularly to more than 100 people. When Sri Krishna learnt about this money, he asked King Satrajit to give it to him. But Satrajit refused to give the money. Once, Satrajit's brother, Prasen, put this money in his neck and went for hunting when a lion attacked him and killed him and took the money and ran away. Later, a forest king named Jambuvan killed this lion and took the money and put it in the neck of his daughter. Here, because Prasenya did not return with the money, Satrajit thought that definitely this is Sri Krishna's act. Sri Krishna came to know about this. Hence, he went in search of Prasen so that he could clarify the matter. In search of Prasen, Sri Krishna came to the jungle, but on reaching there, he saw Prasen's dead body on the ground. Nearby, there were footprints of the lion on the ground. He followed the footprints and came to the caves of King Jambavan. Seeing a stranger in the cave, Jambavan's daughter started shouting. Hearing his daughter's shouts, Jambavan came there and attacked Sri Krishna. They both fought for 21 days. Because of this, there was a big commotion in Dwarka. In Gokul, Nand and Yashoda came to know about this. So they started worrying about Krishna. They both sincerely kept Sankashta Chaturthi's fast. Through the blessings of Sri Ganesh, Sri Krishna won this fight. So Jambuvan gave his daughter Jambuvani in marriage and the money to Sri Krishna. Everybody was rejoicing in Gokul and Dwarka. It is believed that the reason for the blame of robbery came on Sri Krishna because previously in the month of Bhadrapad, on Ganesh Chaturthi day, while he was coming back from the forest along with his friends from Gopal, he saw the reflection of the moon in the rain water puddle which was made by the cow's feet. Because Sri Ganesh had cursed the moon earlier, Sri Krishna had to face this problem. But because of the power of Sankashta Chaturthi's fast, this problem got resolved. Sri Krishna returned the money back to Satrajit. Satrajit asked Sri Krishna to forgive him and gave his daughter Satyabhama to Krishna. On every Krishna Chaturthi's month, Sankashta Chaturthi's fast is kept. Through this fast, Sri Ganesh blesses you and you are protected from problems and the devotee's wishes are fulfilled.
We know that Maharshi Vedavyas has written the Mahabharata. But very few people know that when Vedavyas was narrating, Ganpati was writing the Mahabharata for him. But he understood that it is not possible for him to sit down all by himself and recollect all his life experience and write it. But among all the gods, he couldn't find anyone who could write this. So Vedavyas went to Brahmadev. And he told Brahmadev, "My God of God, I have decided to write a Mahabharat based on the life experience. But it is not possible for me to understand every shloka and write its meaning all by myself. So I need a writer who would be able to understand the meaning of every shloka I say and write it down." Hearing this, Brahmadev told Maharshi, "Hey Mahamuni, your idea to write the Mahabharat is really good. I'm very sure that you will finish this good work very soon. And no one is more capable to write this other than Shiva's own son, Ganesh. That's why get Ganesh ready for this work as soon as possible." Hearing Brahmadev's answer, Maharshi Vyas went to Ganesh and requested Ganesh, "Hey Ganesh, I have come to you because Brahmadev has sent me to you. It is my wish that you will help me in writing my Mahabharat." Hearing this, Ganesh told him, "Hey Maharshi, I shall fulfill your wish, but I have a condition." So Maharshi asked, "What is it?" So Ganesh replied, "When I am writing, you must be continuously narrating. If you stop in between, I will lose my concentration. Likewise, I will not like any kind of waste of time. If I lose my concentration, I would not be able to bring a continuity. Only if you can narrate continuously, without stopping, I can be your writer." Maharshi Vyas accepted this condition and said, "Hey Vignahartha, I accept this condition. But unless understanding whatever I say, you will not write. It is very important to understand every shloka and then write it down. It is not appropriate and possible to write even a single sentence without understanding." Ganesh also agreed to what Maharshi had to say. Hence Maharshi Vyas started narrating the story. After every shloka, Vedavyas used to narrate a parable and Ganesh used to write it down. While narrating the Mahabharat, Vedavyas realized that Ganesha understood the meaning of the shlokas and wrote them very fast. So Vedavyas started telling him more difficult shlokas with very deep meaning. So it took Ganesh more time to understand them and write it. In the meantime, Maharshi Vyas used to write new shlokas and keep them ready. In this manner, Mahabharat was smoothly completed, and even today we can take its pleasure.